scatting over that bridge there.
There is nothing wrong with your perception of reality. Move it!
Now we got something going here. I love it.
We control your emotions.
I hung out at a music store, of course, where I took lessons. That was where I hung out after school and stuff if I wasn't at home practicing. I think my first experience with Hendrix was with the first album. Got the album and was just like, wow, what's this? And I heard all these sounds I never heard before. '68, I think it was April. I grew up in the Boston area, and Jimmy was playing at the Garden, Boston Garden, and I got tickets to that show. And that was like a life-altering experience for me. I went out and bought a Fender guitar the next day.
Up in New Hampshire called The Barn. You know, there was this one famous band that would come up from New York and play there with this singer, Steven. And that's when the band was called The Chain Reaction. You know, it was a whole level above any of the other bands around there.
Like, let's see, 68, 69. It was an amazing time in music. I had a summer job at this place called the Anchorage. I made friends with a couple of people, and I said, yeah, I'm looking to have a band. And somebody said, well, I know this guy, Tom Hamilton, who plays bass. Next thing we know, we have our summer band, and we called it the Jam Band. The way I met Steven, he was at a point his band had broken up, and he was looking for something to do at the beginning of that summer.
I quit my last band and I was fucking a lahoo to her. I was crying. I was in no more bands. The dream was over. I was mowing the lawn at a place called Trail Rico, my family place. He drives up in an MG. We go and he's playing that night. Come on, man, come hear my band. So I went and heard him. It was the jam band, Joe Perry Jam Band. I'm down in Florida. I'm at the Marlin Hotel. I'm living in a room. I'm sober. When the sun went down, I turned the light on and it started raining. So I did that for until the sun came up and I turned the light off. I would get so tired, I'd feel stoned. And I would write.
Since we started this band.
No more, no more. No more, no
from the 60s. With the best of them, I got high. 69 was Woodstock. I went early and left 3 days later. But I remember walking down this path. It was called Groovy Way. And I stole this banner off the trees, which we used for Aerosmith in the beginning. It was two guys looking at each other, you know, smoking a joint, and that was the Aerosmith thing in the beginning, but so I'm tripping on acid. And these helicopters are coming by with 500 pounds of hot dogs, and they're dropping them. They're dropping them in the field, and you hear this. And I shake it up. And then another giant pile of pots and pans. I grabbed the pots and pans and I started. And some other guy walks over and he's going. Another guy comes over and he starts doing this. By the time I was done, an hour later, there was 50 people banging on every pot there was there. That was a moment. And then when I got up from that, tripping my ass off, I walked down the path, and walking towards me was one guy. And it was Joey Kramer, my drummer, who I knew from high school, but that I met there.
His playing is big.
Well, he's really loud.
Tenacious.
Awesome.
Sweet.
You know, loud.
Scenic.
The meter is picked.
Crazy.
F***ed.
When I grew up in the 50s, I lived with my family in the Bronx and then in Yonkers, New York. It was my mom, my dad, my three little sisters, and little Joey always running around getting into trouble. I thought I wanted to go to Berklee School of Music. I went to Berklee for about 3 weeks. I was living in an apartment with two other guys that went to Berklee. I was down on Newbury Street one day in a leather store who a friend of mine, Raymond, had, and he told me about these two guys that he knew that were moving down from New Hampshire and wanted to start a band.
We were looking around for a drummer to replace the drummer that we had up in New Hampshire.
First time I heard Joey play, I was like, wow, we can get that guy. We'll be good.
What I am is a street player. You know, I've never taken any lessons and I'm completely self-taught. What I bring to the table is emotion and feel. And that's what my playing is all about. Projecting that forward and powering the band like a freight train. The one consistent factor in my life is playing my drums. But I very simply love to play in this band. And I love what I do. I love how I do it. It makes me feel good. It kind of completes me. That's pretty much it, man. You know, I love what I do.
You know, Aerosmith wouldn't be Aerosmith without his drums.
Mr. Kramer on the drums!
Welcome for Aerosmith.
Yeah, we're just hanging out.
Oh, come on, guys. Free pickled eggs.
All right.
Yeah. Hello, St. Louis.
That's Springfield, Stephen.
Yeah, right.
Are you ready to rock?
Yeah. Hi, this is Lou Reed.
This is Joey Kramer from Aerosmith, and you're watching V66 in stereo.
You made all
this is Tom Hamilton from
and they had to be 25.
Jungle boogie, bada bada, jungle boogie.
Bada. Oh, Mr. Leno, sir, hey. Would you like the usual?
Yeah, that'd be swell, guys, sure.
Six dogs with everything! Mr. Leno, sir.
Yes.
Me and my friend Joe here from Boston, same place you are.
Huh.
And we was wondering if you could help us fit into the show business thing, you know what I mean?
Get into show business, huh?
Steven, you're not a well individual. I think I'd let you know now.
Oh, my God. Hi, this is Steven Tyler.
And I'm Joe Perry.
The talk.
Shut up after that, God damn it!
Ready? Rolling. Two. Hi, this is Steven Tyler.
And I'm Joe Perry, one of the Toxic Twins.
One more time.
I'll say Toxic Twins.
No, I want to say it.
Okay,
I came up with
it. You can say Toxic Twins.
Everybody knows Edna.
Yeah. Edna's amazing. After a night with Edna, I couldn't walk this way, that way, or any other way. Ooh la la.
I think it's bad because
my heart's got time. Oh. And you want to over your dogs. That's where my baby stays. Oh, God, I think I better change my sobriety date.
I'm back, baby.
Oh,
we're not worthy! We're not worthy! You're worthy, you're worthy. Get up.
You guys were excellent tonight.
Hey, thanks a lot. We'll see you inside.
We're planning on it.
Mr. Whitford, what kind of guitar do you play?
I prefer missionary work.
Oh, what position is that?
And cheerleader.
Steven Tyler, Joe Perry's just arrived. Aerosmith is here, campers. We're going to find out a little bit about the Sunday concert at Sullivan Stadium. Of course, Walk This Way, the big video request here at V66. Any surprises in the show for Sunday?
Oh, yes.
Down the
And finally, last but definitely not least, thank you, Tipper and Jesse, for making sure that as long as there are a few four-letter words in the album, it will always sell an extra million copies.
Good evening.
Back to me now.
First of all, there was no radio station to listen to be exposed to all kinds of different music, you know? But the music up there was whatever the summer kids brought up and showed everybody, and that's where a lot of the information came from. It was like, you either listen to Top 40 or you listen to underground music. You know, all these incredible bands like the Yardbirds and the Stones and the Byrds and Jefferson Airplane and all these incredible bands that were creating this new music. So that was what I was exposed to.
Right, okay, bass player, just my all-time favorite, John Entwistle.
All right.
John Paul Jones and Paul McCartney is a fabulous bass player.
Sweet emotion. That's how a band comes together, you know? Tom Hamilton, in his outtakes, as he called them, sweet emotion. That's Tom Hamilton.
Lake Sunapee. This is where all the dreams came from. I first grew up here and had all those feelings about the water and the smell. I went out in a canoe before and I was paddling in by myself and the smell off the lake. And this is the true Stephen. That is it. At this restaurant, the Anchorage.
And I used to do everything from sweep the floor to scrub the grill to make the fried clams and the French fries.
French fries were brilliant. They were great. They were crispy, delicious, thick. Who made these?
I can remember them sitting at a table like down at the other end of the restaurant and throwing food. I remember having to clean it up.
I went back and I said, hey, who made these French fries? And there he was. And I'm telling you, Joe Perry, short hair, black horn rim glasses with tape. I'm mowing the lawn, Joe pulls up in his little MG, and he said, I'm playing up here at the barn. It's just an old barn where the band used to play. Black hair, he was good looking. He didn't give two craps about anything. Just what I love.
I grew up in a small suburban town in Hopedale, Massachusetts. So there wasn't much music around. I didn't even know a guitar player at the time. I picked up a guitar and I heard rock and roll, and rock and roll was something I just got inside. I got got a student guitar. I finally convinced my parents to get me a guitar. I love just the way it, the visceral feeling of it, or the physical feeling of the guitar vibrating and the way it felt in my hands.
For every song you've ever heard, for every one of those licks, there's 20 that got lost in the ether. The way he played his guitar and practiced at night, he'd fucking nod out. He'd be sitting in his chair, and the fucking chair, the couch caught on fire. I walked in with a pot of water. And he's laying there, room's full of smoke. And I went, Joe, what the fuck, man? And he's playing this riff, and we turned it into a song.
God, I have an electric guitar, because I don't know what else I would do.
My dad, Vic Tallarico, who went to Juilliard in New York, and I grew up under the piano, and I listened, my dad would practice every day. On a Steinway.
And when you take life's emotions and you go through in life, and you lay it over a Bach or a Brahms sonata, it takes on different meaning.
So, well, 65, 64, I was a drummer in a band. At school, you know, the then I bought a set of drums because I wasn't getting looked at. I thought, if we get a little band together, play at lunch, that'd be really cool. We were called the Maniacs. So we played at lunch, and I went, holy shit, Marsha Resnick is talking to me now. Then in 65, 66, 67, Chain Reaction, 68, The Strangers. I knew why those bands didn't make it. But I knew in my heart that if I had a bro in a band, if we can live together, smoke weed together, fuck girls together in the same apartment, we'll have it. And all I want to do is get my fucking toe in the door. I just love Joe. And I saw him in the beginning, and I knew he was that. I knew he was that. We decided to move down to Boston. I got really tight with Joe. And you know what I hear when I listen to him playing? Whoa, shit. I'd love to tell you, I always knew I'd make it. You don't know until you write that first song. When I wrote that first song with Joe Perry, that's when it game over.
Well, you know, when I first met Steven, I realized he had the same kind of energy I did. There's been some bumps and grinds, but we always wanted to make this music, and nothing else sounded like that whenever we played with anybody else.
So get five guys together that love what each other's doing. I love it when Joey Kramer plays. Brad Whitford plays guitar like a madman. Joe Perry, Tom Hamilton, you know? To love what these guys do and then write songs. Who are we?
I'll tell you, being in this band Aerosmith is fucking nuts. 5 minutes ago, I got back from an interview. I'm in the shower now, and in 5 minutes, I gotta go to a gig.
Whoops. Oh, wanna pick up the soap?
We love getting up on stage, and we love rocking out, and we love playing, and we love being in front of the audience.
There's a vibe you get being out there in 200,000, 300,000 people that's like, it almost brings tears to your eyes. It's so overwhelming. And then when you hear your favorite song from your favorite band, well, it's like beyond your wildest dreams.
That was part of what sucked you in. Look what the girls are doing in the audience. this Aerosmithsonian, the roadies would fill up the road box with all the ladies' underwear and bras and stuff that would be thrown on the stage through the course of the tour.
See what's out there now? I mean, every night we walk on stage, on the lights, Tim, what does the audience do?
Lights go, all house lights out.
The place goes nuclear. It sounds like when they threw the Christians to the lions, right?
Right. Joe Perry and Steve Tyler were a huge, huge part of my growing up. And so much that I had my mom paint me on the wall looking like those guys.
Aerosmith rocks. I was about 14 years old. And I discovered that record at this girl's house. She put the Aerosmith rocks record on, and I completely focused on that record for the next hour. I played it over and over again and forgot about her.
For me, it's a sense of incredible lyrics and melodies, but still rock and roll and sexy.
What is not to love? We're only the greatest rock and roll band in the history of rock and roll, and it's not because they're from Boston, okay? It's just a known fact. In 2020, it'll be their 50-year anniversary. Who out there is rocking harder than them? I'm sorry, but nobody.
First time I heard Dream On when I was a kid, blew my mind. Blew my mind.
Walk This Way to remix with Run-DMC is the illest thing that's ever happened to me.
Oh, this is It, y'all. Rocking with the Aerosmith, y'all.
Stupid without. I mean, you know.
It's a princess without tits.
What the fuck are you looking at?
How often do we get to reclaim rock and roll history?
We got the Aerosmith fan, it's here.
This thing is crazy, dude.
I want this band to look like it did when Aerosmith rode around in it. The story begins.
Favorite blues. I cover her with kisses, and when we're in.